Hi, I'm Anu, and welcome to Let's Talk Life with AIA. How important is it to have a plan for the year? I know we all make new plans for the new year, and just 1 month down the line, you know, most of us just abandon that plan. And if 2020 was anything to go by, you know, all the plans that the world made had to be set aside because the world had other plans. But does that mean we make no plans? So how do we face 2021? To answer this very important question, this is why I have a very inspirational man, Yasas Hevage, who is a passionate advocate of cycling. He is a tutor, a sales coach, and a marketing educator. He's also the founder of Daffodil, Spinner, and Snipex. He's also probably the only Sri Lankan to have cycled across the Himalayas. So he's going to talk to us about how important it is to plan for the future. Such a pleasure to have you here, Yasas.
Thank you, Anu.
So, Yasas, success is a different interpretation for different people. Tell me what you consider success.
You're right. I mean, it's a funny thing
how
people define success.
Absolutely.
In a Sri Lankan context, most of the time, the parents define success or your boss defines success. And we have a bit of a confused life trying to figure out what success is.
Yeah, I agree.
I come from a background where my father helped me to have a free childhood and gave that freedom to figure out success for me.
Okay.
For example, at a point, my success was riding a bicycle in the Veerasekara Mahavatha from bottom to top.
Right.
Faster. Not to be defined by what others are going to think of you.
Yeah.
But the reality is the world puts a lot of pressure on you.
Oh, yeah.
And that pressure is what confuses life a lot. So, I mean, if you're already living in a context of that type of constraints, I'm not here to tell you that break all that away and find your own form of success.
Absolutely.
Because you will have a target tomorrow, you have a job tomorrow, and people will define you.
Yeah.
But if you take a step back, which COVID helps us to do,
is
to relook at who you are, why are you here, what life is. Well, success suddenly got defined to your doorstep and that little four walls.
Yeah.
Because you are no more no one. Nobody in the world, right?
Especially for a lot of children as well, you know, in the context of children and parents to be interacting together.
Yeah. Absolutely. Whether you had 50,000 rupees, you had a billion, you had to eat from the same pot at home.
Yeah.
So I hope this experience helped people to figure out what success looks like in reality. But then if you have impact to make a bigger positive change in the world or in your company, thousands of people, well, I guess that could be taken as a big opportunity and you can define your success.
Yeah.
But if you're a mother with two kids at home and you're going to define their life, for me, that's equal success as somebody who's got 1,000 employees and running a large company.
Absolutely.
So the whole idea is not to try not to compare.
So Yasas, tell me, what inspired you to be who you are today?
It's hard to pinpoint one thing.
Okay.
But I guess it's always circumstance, right?
Yeah.
What surrounds you that gives you opportunities or it gives you a challenge that makes who you are. So at my job at the bank, I remember I had a challenge of counting cash.
Right.
And I had to count coins and I had to think out of the box, what do I do with these coins? And I used to call two companies who needed coins, a fast food company and a Chinese company who does this Chinese food.
Yeah.
And I wanted them to count my coins. So you are always driven by the market, the opportunity, what people throw at you. So that's my story from my life at the two banks.
Right.
Maybe riding a bicycle out there.
Absolutely.
You think everything is good, but you have a puncture or you fall,
Absolutely.
You break a bone. But that's what makes who you are.
Absolutely. You've got to be ready to roll with the blows.
So that's my formula too.
Which is very interesting because I'm clearly you were very successful at both banks. So what happened? What happened for you to take that decision to move out of the banking sector entirely and go into something completely different from the corporate sector at 37, mind you.
So it's a funny thing. I got into studying the subject of planning later in my life because I became an educator for marketing,
right,
etc. But for some reason, at age 19, I set a goal that I want to retire at 40 not only me, a colleague of mine. We were just counting cash in the bank. We were clerks. So that kept ringing in my mind. Having this goal, I want to retire. I didn't even know what retirement meant.
Yeah.
And I also, one day, when the CEO came to the bank, I saw the car he drove, 19.
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, I want to be a CEO of the bank. I didn't realize in a bank, you can't achieve both of that together. Nobody becomes a CEO at 40.
Yeah.
But what really happened was I left the bank at 37. So when you have this goal, sometimes your plans fall along that. I joined a branch just to be a branch banker, which is a great job.
Okay.
But when opportunity came to set up the sales team of the banking industry at that time, I quickly latched on to it because my goal was to fast track. And I quickly moved into the right places that gave me those opportunities.
Yeah.
Then I spent 7 years in a multinational bank.
Yeah.
And I knew I had to move to understand Sri Lanka. And that was to a local bank. So by the time I finished my 17 years, I was clear that I found my space. I've seen what the world looks like. I've seen what Sri Lanka looks like. And I said, you know, I think that's the right time that I should take a call. By that time, of course, I've got into cycling and it was becoming a big part of my life.
Yeah. So you, while at the bank, you had started cycling already?
Yeah, I used to bike to work.
Yeah.
I wanted to, you know, cut down my carbon footprint. Why should I drive every day was already in my head. And being a marketer, I always felt there was an opportunity to use a bicycle as a vehicle to get a message out on sustainability, on health. Because the truth is, you don't need a gym if you either walk or ride.
Yeah. And I completely agree with you.
Yeah, it's a 1 hour, maybe half an hour that you might want to wake up early. Most people can get there. It's just that I felt this was a great way rather than going around giving lectures. But I can use a bicycle to get a message out, and that's what I've been doing for 10 years.
But surely, when you made this choice, Yasas, the financial consideration, because you are used to a certain kind of lifestyle.
For sure.
Your family is certainly used to a certain kind of lifestyle. Even your parents would have been used to a certain kind of lifestyle.
Yeah.
And they have these expectations of you. So what kind of financial planning did you do to kind of bring this whole idea into fruition?
So at a point, you will come across a term called financial independence,
yeah.
right? It's a tough one to define. What does it mean? But I guess COVID taught us cash is king. So it makes sense to have some cash with you if you can afford it. Otherwise, it's not a smart idea to just chuck up a job which pays you monthly salary.
Mm-hmm.
So I did work towards having a bit of cash. But I'll tell you honestly, I didn't have all the cash in the world. But by that time, I built my ability to generate cash. As a sales and marketing professional, I knew I could go out there and create income. But that's the confidence you have.
Absolutely.
And then, of course, you need a family who is also going to say, okay, we are fine for you to take that risk. My wife, if she was not there supporting that decision, I don't think that would be possible. But as a bank, I would say we would generally tell you have 6 months of cash with you.
Yeah.
Even a COVID, you might be able to spin it out if you got that cash. Land won't help you.
Yeah, that's true, actually. We found it out the hard way, you know.
That's right. So having a bit of cash, having confidence that you can generate some money, is what gives you that confidence to go chase your passion, which I did.
So Yasas and I have been talking about, you know, following your passions, identifying your passions, and, you know, laying that proper foundation so that you can follow your passions. But tell me, what keeps you motivated to keep doing what you're doing? Clearly, it makes you happy.
I guess it's about seeing achievement of whatever you get your hand into.
Right, right.
So if you draw a line, if you create something, it's about the sense of achievement, right? So that's what keeps me motivated. If you take a bicycle, I could have just ridden the bicycle around my home.
Yeah.
Or around Vihar Mahadevi Park. But I said, you know what, I'll take a bike and ride from one corner of the country to the other. I'll stop when the road finishes.
Absolutely.
Luckily, it's Sri Lanka. If it's India, I'll be still riding.
Yeah, absolutely. I was just thinking, but then you did Himalaya.
I ran out of mountains in this country. So it's about a sense of purpose, and I say I want to achieve the ultimate.
Now, when you're working for an institution, well, the things that you have to do are relatively less. You know, your job role is clearly defined, but no, like you, you're passionate about riding, plus you have these three other entities, business entities that you manage. So it's all on you.
Yeah.
So when you have that kind of context, how do you manage the work and life, you know, that balance because I'm sure it's now more precarious than ever.
For sure. I honestly don't believe in that thing called balance.
Right.
This work-life balance is an employee term.
Yeah. Okay.
But the point is, if your work and life are one, and then you start enjoying it, mm-hmm. you'll find a balance within that. And especially, guys, at this moment, we got to come out and be ready to push limits.
Yeah.
And I hope your family is going to be with you on this process, because 2021 is not going to be
easy.
Rosy, right?
So absolutely. That actually brings me to my next question.
Right.
So how are you going to plan? Now, we are in a brand new year. How are you going to plan for 2021?
I think somebody once said, right, plans are irrelevant, but planning is important.
Oh, yeah.
So we got to keep planning on a daily, hourly, sometimes weekly, quarterly basis. Yesterday, I was having a chat with my team in one of the other companies, which are not listed here. Mm-hmm. And he was saying, Yasir, I can't make a man for 1 year. I said, absolutely. 3 months and we're talking. That's the truth. But said that, what one could and should do is simplify, simplify, simplify. If you're running a company, simplify it. Absolutely. Cut the cost down. If you're an individual, if you can't live with 50,000 rupees, maybe you made some wrong choices, like you bought a house that you can't afford, maybe you got a car with a bigger lease, 2 cars, sell one, for God's sake. You can take a taxi now.
Yeah, oh yeah.
So there are many ways to simplify your business, your life, your company, so that you're ready for the next wave. I hope it doesn't come, but I'm sure it will, right? It will, some form.
It might,
I'm
yes.
I'm waiting for the wave. There's no data and there's no petrol, and you're at home and COVID. I know that's scary.
That is really scary.
But the point is, you saw the worst, maybe, but maybe it's not the worst. So keep your costs down and then be good at something.
Yeah.
I get up in the morning and I listen to some audiobook on a topic that is interesting to me, which is cycling or marketing or education. So invest in your education, invest in your exposure. If you're good at cooking, master it. Because if it locks down, you only might have those 100 neighbors, but you will sell. The Vatalappang and some. If market grows, build the Vatalappang.com, become the largest player.
Yeah.
But that's the market to happen, right?
Absolute optimist.
So be good at what you do. Master something, because finally it might boil down to your little world.
Yeah.
Might be your house
or
might be your neighborhood. If the country opens up, you've got 22 million people.
Yeah, why not?
Go and play.
So Yasas and I are talking about planning ahead, especially for 2021. But also, I think as much as financial, the aspect of finance is important, health is a key thing. You know, and a lot of people, nobody's getting any younger. And certainly, you need to keep in top form to do that. So do you have any kind of like a strategy that you follow when it comes to, keeping on top of that?
Health point of view.
Absolutely. Yeah. Health is a key thing.
Health is wealth, right?
without a doubt.
As Lord Buddha says, arogya paramala,
right?
Right. End of the day. So I think more you figure out this whole game you play is within your body.
Yeah.
And however spiritually you are in the right place or you have all the intellectual capacity, one move, wrong move, you have a slip disc, everything is gone.
Yeah.
So when you understand that, you realize you have to look after this whole machine. And if you make use of it, you can do wonders that you can't even imagine. I've seen people at 40, 50, 60, 70 on a bicycle doing things that you can't even imagine.
Mm-hmm.
So I wake up in the morning and I ensure that I first get my physical aspects, which means cycling,
right,
into the system. And I don't go to a gym because I ride to wherever I want to go to work or for a class or a meeting. So it becomes part of life.
How important is health management when it comes to planning the year ahead, planning your future?
Absolutely. I think there's no question. If you are tomorrow quarantined for a health issue, your job is gone and your business is closed.
Yeah.
I know the risk of that because I run a couple of small businesses. So you've got to manage health
in
that context. Secondly, this battle you might have to fight by yourself.
Right.
Finally.
Right. Yeah.
And if you're not physically fit, you can't think. Basically, everything crashes when you crash. So if you understand that, you got to look after the machine, you got to look after your physique, you have to be fresh in your mind. So I don't think there's any question that you got to start with you. That's the simplest form of being prepared.
Yeah.
and there onwards to be able to keep the rest of the people around you physically fit, your employees, your teams, your family. So I guess it's, I think this year taught us the power and the value of health and the medical profession for that matter. I hope people are getting less sick, by the way, now.
Yeah, actually, because, you know, you're absolutely covered, you know, and people are working out more and, you know.
And add the workout to that, add a bit of meaningful eating to that. Yeah. And then obviously you have to think of how you're going to sustain economically. So health is key for 2021.
So looking back, you know, at 2020, is there anything that you would do different? And is there any advice that you'd give people to do different?
So from my point of view, I guess I knew the formula, which is required to be able to manage risk. And when you run a business, you know, the worst case is disruption, but we never knew it's going to be disrupted like this. So you got to have your cash managed, right? You got to have your cash sources. You could have a bit of cash reserves. So I guess personally, I probably over-invested on areas that I should not have because we never thought this type of disruption would come.
Nobody in the world.
So you got to be smart in understanding where you put your cash in. And having access to that cash is something that you need to have. But also having multiple cash sources. For example, my spinner business, I had zero cash because we had to close the restaurant overnight. But my education business continued. So there was cash coming in. And so you got to have some, we call it diversification, right? And it's multiple sources, if you have it, it's a great thing. It's a good advice for the ones who run restaurants and hotels.
Right, of course.
There's one airport and every tourist comes from that. If that closes down, what's your plan B? So having a bit of plan B, we call it diversification. I guess some of those are the learnings that you need to take from 2020 when you go back to 2021.
So Yasas, do tell us your success habits and tips, you know, for planning for 2021. What would you do?
So I guess principles are principles.
Right.
We all have 24 hours.
Yeah.
So how do you use it? Getting up in the morning is the first thing you can do. So if you're not getting up at 4 o'clock before COVID, then maybe you're out of the game. Because every mother, who has bigger responsibilities, they're up at 4, no alarm clock. That's why we have food on the table. The men are a bit lazy. I know COVID has got the streets empty and you don't have to rush to work, but you've got to wake up before others do. So at least 5 a.m. you're up and do something for yourself to build yourself.
Right.
Before the world starts asking for reports, food.
Okay.
These, even for the ladies, they're very good at doing things for others and they forget to commit time for themselves.
Okay.
So invest time by getting up in the morning, do something yourself, and there onwards, whether it's something for your mind or for your spiritual enlightenment or for your physical exercise like I do, is the formula that should get your day started. What happens at 10 o'clock is out of our control.
Right.
But what you know for sure is today you're going to do better than what you did yesterday.
Right.
And if a full toss comes, score a 6. If not, come home without getting out.
Right.
21. That's the plan.
That's wonderful advice, Yasas. I'm so glad that you've had, you know, decided to come and have this chat with us.
Happy.
And, you know, you're an inspiration, I think, for a lot of people out there. And especially people who work in the corporate sphere, who have thought, you know, that this is all there is to life. You know, I think you've given them a fresh perspective. So thank you so much.
Pleasure, Anu. Thanks.